of self-improvement, both in terms of body image and self-worth. With a subculture rich in history, these men have given rise to a world of intense competition, driving competitors to bring their bodies to the absolute physical peak.
It's very much a lifestyle. It's a 24/7 occupation at the highest level.
Explore the lives of these individuals and what it takes to be selected to be the best in the world, Mr. Olympia, and how that criteria has developed and changed over the years.
In bodybuilding, you can't tiptoe your way through a workout. You can't fake eating 6 and 7 meals a day. There's no way you can properly recover by training hard and then going out partying all night. It's all or none.
Defining what the best means and how it has evolved over the past 50 years.
I truly feel that my type of physique is gonna recharge the sport a little bit.
This is the evolution of bodybuilding. Before bodybuilding became a controlled sport, men of great strength were seen as curiosities rather than athletes. Audiences of circus acts and vaudeville shows were amazed to watch gargantuan men crush steel and lift unfathomably heavy items. And yet it was the spectacle of the show, not the physical prowess of the man, that was admired. But one of these young men would break the mold set forth by his predecessors and influence generations to come.
That mold was broken by Eugene Sandow, who was also a strength athlete, one of the strongest men in the world, but he had abs, delts, he was really defined, and although he started off as a strong man, there was such a sort of a focus on, nobody's seen a build like this, and especially from the women really loved this guy, that then he started doing physique displays as part of his strength act.
Sandow's memorable musculature became a favorite among audiences in the late 1800s, and with his fame came great influence. Sandow was a shrewd businessman. He published several books on physical training and opened the Institute of Physical Culture in Britain. His fitness magazine, Bodybuilding, gave the future sport a name. But Sandow's long-lasting contribution to the bodybuilding world was the very first physique show, called The Great Competition. With a legacy that the entire bodybuilding world owes its success to, Sandow has been unforgettably remembered as the father of bodybuilding.
The real first bodybuilding contest was held at the Albert Hall. He organized it, didn't compete in it because he would have walked it. And the guys were judged. There was 12,000 people there to see it. One of the judges was Conan Doyle, who's the author of Sherlock Holmes. And then after that, physique contest started to spring up sporadically. Every few years, some of the best built man in the world.
Though it wasn't until 1940 that Joe Weider, along with his brother Ben, launched his magazine Your Physique, and a few years later created the International Federation of Bodybuilders. It was the improvement in self-image made possible by bodybuilding that earned Weider's praise.
Joe and Ben lived in the Jewish ghettos of Montreal, brought up in poverty. And they founded an industry, the bodybuilding and fitness industry. Now, we've all heard multiple stories of Jewish kids coming out of ghettos and getting into the movie industry or business, but these are established businesses. They were already going and they got involved. They built the whole thing from nothing. You know, Joe ran his first magazine, produced his first magazine on his kitchen table on a mimeograph for $7. Ben traveled the world in the 50s to places. In those days, air travel wasn't as easy as it is now. He went to China and Russia. Here's a Jewish guy going to Egypt and you know, getting them in the bodybuilding fold. There was no religious or racial barriers, you know. So they were really unique in what they did.
The 1950s were drawing to a close, and the sport turned industry's focus to the next decade was about to shift almost universally to California. And who better to personify the iconic California lifestyle than the legend Larry Scott?
Yeah, Larry Scott was the personification of the California beach boy, even though he was born in Idaho and his blonde hair was dyed.
I met Joe in 61 through the magazines, because I was appearing in the magazines, and he took an interest in me and started putting his arm around me and started seeing how he could help my career, just out of the goodness of his heart, and for his business too, you know, because he was trying to get some pictures of the guys for his magazines. So it was a win-win situation.
The biggest magazine in those days in the 30s and 40s was Strength and Health, run by Bob Hoffman, who did bodybuilding but was more into weightlifting. He'd give them preference.
And at that time, there was a real struggle going on between Bob Hoffman and Joe Weider. And Bob Hoffman hated bodybuilders, but he was a powerlifting guy. And so he thought that was sissy stuff to be a bodybuilder, and you should be showing you how much you could lift and everything. So they didn't get along.
He used to hold contests, bodybuilding contests, but in conjunction with the weightlifting. And the weightlifting would take first, go on first. And the bodybuilders would not come on till midnight. They were like second-class citizens. Joe wanted to give bodybuilders the proper respect and forum.
I said, I want to be Mr. America. And he says, why don't you enter my contest? And it was the IFBB. And it was just starting, this idea. And I thought, I didn't say it to him, but I thought, who wants to win IFBB? Who knows IFBB? I want to win AAU, Mr. America. That's what I want. I said, no, Joe. I said, I got my heart set on AAU. He says, you can't win that. I says, why not? And he says, because that's fixed. He picks who wins that contest. And I said, well, I think I can do it. I still can't. So, and I met Isaac Berger, who was a powerlifter, and he says, I know Bob Hoffman. He says, you got to meet him, you got to get to know him, you got to get in good with Bob Hoffman, or you'll never win his contest. So he said, at the next Mr. America, which was in Santa Monica, in which Joe Abenda won it, he says, you come backstage after that contest, and I'll introduce you to Bob Hoffman. I said, all right, great. So we went backstage at the AU, and he took me up to Bob Hoffman, and he says, Bob, there's someone here who wants to meet you. Larry Scott would like to meet you. And Bob Hoffman turned around, he looked at me, he said, oh yes, I've seen him in other magazines. And turned his back on me. Isaac Berger walked off, and I'm standing there on stage. He's got his back turned to me and just leaves me there. And I thought, I walked off. And I thought, here I'm talking to Joe Weider, and he's given me all this help and encouragement and everything. He turns his back on me when I want to enter his contest. I said, that's it. I'm done with AAU.
Joe Weider, you know, he was a visionary. And he established the Mr. Olympia contest in 1965. And the reason he established it, there was two federations. And you could win Mr. America once, and that was it. You could win the IFBB Mr. Universe. But then there was nowhere for these guys to go. So he said, I want to create the ultimate bodybuilding competition. And he was having dinner with Larry Scott in 1964.
We were sitting there having dinner, and we started talking about, and I had just won the universe. And they said, we need to come up with a contest in which all the Mr. Universes can compete in, all the Mr. Americas and Mr. Universes can compete against one another and see who is the best in the world. And that's a great idea. Maybe we get Bill Pearl and these other guys that were my heroes to come in. I'd like to see how I would stand up next to them.
And Joe says, look, we're going to get a new competition. And what are you going to call it, Larry said. And they were drinking Olympia beer. This is a true story. And Joe said, well, call it Mr. Olympia.
Yeah, let's not call it that. That's a beer. Let's call it something that sounds health-producing or something. Like Mr. Broccoli. That wasn't what I said. But something better than Olympia. Well, anyway, I lost. I voted on it. He says, no, Olympia. He says, think of Mount Olympus, like the grandeur of that. And I said, yeah, I can see that. And so we decided then there to call it Mr. Olympia.
Now, if they'd have been drinking Schlitz Malt Ale, we'd have had Mr. Schlitz Malt Ale now.
Well, let's see. I won the first Mr. Olympia in 1965. and they provided a $1,000 gift. First time. I mean, you had to pay your own way to get the show. You had to pay your own flights, everything. You had to have a job, too, because nobody was paying for your supplements or anything like that. You had to have a job, so you worked, make the time to the gym, go to school. I had to rush from the school over to the gym, get my workout done. Then when some Joe gave you a $1,000 gift, that was great, man. $1,000 was a lot of money then.
And people still say, Larry's effect on the audience, they've never witnessed anything like it. When his music came, he walked out in silhouette and just stood there. And of course, with those arms and those delts, you could tell it was Larry Scott and the hair. You know, he had his own particular shape. He had these great arms, great delts, and he posed, and the audience went nuts. They were standing on the chairs, jumping up and down, and people that were there, I wasn't there, say it was like Beatlemania. It was just absolutely raucous.
And I got a chance to meet Larry Scott and saw him pose from the audience, and wow, what a moment that was. I mean, you've probably read about that, about Larry Scott, his appearance there. It was just tremendous.
I never saw it, never had the opportunity to go and see the Mr. Olympia when Larry Scott won. But I remember reading religiously, and he was so impressive in those days. You know, he had that blonde hair. He had that real California look.
The next year, we Mr. Olympia, and I said, I'm going to go in this one more year. Because I know that the happiness doesn't exist on the stage. It exists in the family. So I want to win it the second time, so at least I can say that it wasn't one time. I won it twice. And then I'm going to retire.
Larry won the Olympia in 65 and 66 in really outstanding fashion. But he was also aware of somebody coming up behind him real fast.
After I was given the trophy, the second Olympia, I said, would you appreciate their loyalty and their adulation and everything? And that's what I told him. I told him from my heart. It was a great honor. Not something that for a little Pocatello kid to get this kind of an honor. And I really appreciated him. But tonight is my last contest.
And Larry, you know, won the title those first 2 years, and then he decided to retire. He had other things to do. And along came Sergio.
When Sergio Oliva came onto the scene, his presence was impossible to ignore. Blessed with an enormous amount of raw talent and driven by a true warrior spirit, Oliva ascended the ranks of his contemporaries with a grace that made him seem almost unreal. His nickname, The Myth, was well earned.
Joe said, I got a fella here that I want you to meet. He's from Cuba. And he's got a great body. And Joe was always bringing those kind of things just to spur you on. And so Sergio Oliva came walking back. He couldn't speak any English at all then. He was just spoke Spanish totally. But I looked at his body and I thought, I am never going to beat this guy. I'd already decided I was going to quit, but I thought, I'm glad I'm quitting because I know I'm not going to beat this guy. He's got natural blessings in his body, his proportions, his size, everything. It was just magnificent. I've never seen a bodybuilder like him.
I first met Sergio Oliva outside Gold's Gym when it was on 2nd Street in Santa Monica. That was the second location. And I still can remember these arms coming out of a Hawaiian shirt with a split in it in order to give him enough room for these huge arms. Sergio is one of the most gifted genetic bodybuilders there ever was. This huge chest, huge arms, flaring thighs, tiny waist, but he was just this incredible display of genetics, and everybody was impressed. Nobody's ever not been impressed by Sergio Oliva.
Now, I had the good fortune of meeting Sergio and becoming friends with him early on. We competed in the 1966 Junior Mr. America contest in San Jose. That was the first national contest I'd ever competed in. I was 19 at the time. And when I met Sergio, I had never seen anybody that genetically gifted. Still to this day, I haven't. I well remember this. Sergio only weighed 197 pounds that day. Yet each one of his thighs measured 29 inches. His waist was only 27. He was so far advanced over the rest of us, Everybody else could have just posed their ass off, and Sergio could have stood there, and he walked away with the contest.
And Sergio just rewrote the books in terms of, you know, round muscle bellies on the small joints. He had this small head that made everything else look massive. You know, it's an illusion. I'd been to a couple of universes and seen all the guys, Arnold, Draper, Park, you know, and impressed, you know. The first time Sergio walked out, I just went back in my seat. He ambled out. There was this, is this human? You know, it was like some sort of holograph that had been made out. The roundness of the muscles, the small waist, the size of his arms when he hit the poses. I've never shot back in my chair at anybody since. You know, it was just amazing.
Though Sergio Oliva was in the best shape of his life in the early 70s, he was succeeded handily by Arnold. As one titan faded and a new one rose into the spotlight, it was the IFBB that was slowly on the rise as the 1960s came to a close.
Well, yeah, along came the 70s, and you know, the culture of the country and the world was changing rapidly with, you know, pop music and everything. The Vietnam War was in full force, which then became such a political issue here in the States. And at that time, you know, when all sorts of wild things were happening, along came Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Sent a letter to Arnold. Arnold called me back. Says, Joe, I don't have any money. I can't buy a ticket on the plane. I have nothing. All he had was his briefcase, you know, with his workout suit and shoes, nothing else.
So along came Arnold, who was a blueprint for what you wanted in a bodybuilder, what Joe Weider wanted. You know, he wanted the best bodybuilder in the world to have charisma, a PR brain, a sense of humor, somebody who could connect with an audience. You could have almost written it and said, let's get this guy.
I told him, I don't want to go home, I want to stay here. I'm near Los Angeles, and movies and everything. That's what I want to be. I said, okay, I'll pay you for your ticket to the plane. And I had a little business there in Florida, and he went to work, and he worked. He wanted to go to school, college school. I gave him money, gave him everything he wanted.
And of course, his nemesis was Sergio Oliva. And he competed one-to-one against Sergio several times, in which a lot of people think Sergio maybe should have won. Just maybe. The problem with Sergio is that he was dealing with Arnold, who is just the smartest bodybuilder on stage ever.
At that time, that was the first contest that he was on his mark. He looked good, and Sergio was a little bit off, and everything was right. And Arnold won, because I well remember we went back to the hotel that night. It was me, Dave Draper, Franco, and Arnold, and he kept saying over and over, I can't believe that I actually beat Sergio. That blew his mind that he actually had toppled Sergio, and then, of course, a few weeks later, he was able to beat him again at the Mr. Olympia.
And it was really his decision. You know, he won the Olympia in 1970 and through to 75 for 6 years, to then concentrate on the Olympia, that then made the Olympia between 70 and 75. That's when the Olympia took over as the contest to win, to decide who's the best physique on the planet.
And then after that, you got Joe's publicity machine behind him.
And there's a certain synchronicity about the whole thing. Joe got the guy he wanted. Arnold met the entrepreneur he needed. They both knew how to promote, you know, the sport as a business and make it, you know, more accessible to the public. The Olympia was established. Arnold started training Gold's Gym. So you had this synchronicity of, you know, the world's best bodybuilders, Zane, Draper, Franco, all in the same gym.
You can't be thinking about yourself. You cannot be worried about what's going on with you. You have to go, okay, I'm ready. I've done everything I can do. Now what's going on around me that I can take advantage of? And nobody was ever better at that than Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Coming off of wins in 1973 for Mr. America and the IFBB Mr. Universe, Lou Ferrigno continued his winning streak in the following year's IFBB Mr. Universe and the Mr. International. That same year, he entered the first Mr. Olympia, taking second. But it was in 1975 that Ferrigno's fortunes began to take an unprecedented turn.
1974 was my first competition in the Mr. Olympia because I was currently the Mr. Universe twice. I won the IBB Miss America. And I knew I was competing against Donald because he was my idol. I really wanted to beat him. I was only 21, he was 26. But I remember we competed together, even though he was much more superior. I only trained 3 months. I found out later why he trained a whole year for the competition. But I was on the same stage with him. In a matter of just a few years, I went from a kid who came 23rd place right on stage with the greatest Schwarzenegger. And I remember when I was on that stage with him, I said, this is such a big leap. No matter what happened in the competition, people are always going to look up to him and I. And it was incredible because it gave me the sense and the motivation to go push even harder, to train even harder. Guys like Arnold and I, back 30, 40 years ago, most of the big guys would go into pro football. But Arnold and I were like the two biggest guys in bodybuilding. So when Pumping Iron came out, the public embraced us. It affected everyone. Like Franco, everybody got a lot of fame. But mostly I, because we're like the giants of bodybuilding. And Arnold always felt that eventually I was going to surpass him. He always said to me, if I had your body, no one would beat me for 15 years. So basically, the beauty about the two of us is that we got involved going the mainstream, going to film. Like I did the Hulk, he did Terminator. So it made us the household name and it helped everyone out.
With Schwarzenegger and Ferrigno both moving on in the wake of their newfound fame, the competitive stage had opened up once again. 1976 began with the birth of one of the sport's greatest rivalries, Frank Zane and Franco Colombo.
Well, that year was going to be me, Franco, and I think Robbie Robertson, a couple other people. I really wanted to win that year because I trained the whole year. But doing the Hulk, it changed and made me so well known because if I walk down the street, everybody knows me. Nobody knows who Franco is. So I made that decision. That's why I came back to competition, because I wanted to stay in the game. But I could not pass the Hulk up because I was the Hulk my whole life. It's a wonderful opportunity. Unfortunately, it had to happen before I was able to compete.
The bodybuilding has always been a progression. The prize money gradually crept up. In 76, I think the total prize money that Franco won was $5,000.
Frank Zane and Franco never got on, even to this day. If you talk to them, Franco particularly, will tell you he beat Zane 20 times. Well, he never did. You know, Zane won more than Franco. But they were polar opposites in personality and physique. You know, Franco had a great back, striations. So he won more on, you know, the impact. Zane was like a walking statue. You know, he practiced his posing to perfection. You know, every pose was thought out so that the waist would be kept slender, the leg would be splayed out to show the quadriceps and calves and everything.
I think I was much more meticulous than anybody else that competed at that time, and probably even now, because that was my background. I was trained as in the sciences. I was prepared to teach chemistry. And so because of that, my exposure to chemistry and my analytical approach to everything with the journals and looking at things and correlating results with what I'm doing to achieve those results, I got nicknamed the chemist.
Frank basically was very dominant in the late 70s, you know, 77, 78, 79. He had the type of physique that was very acceptable to the average guy. And I don't mean in any kind of negative, but the average guy could say, hey, if I trained hard, I could probably look close to that.
And, you know, I basically had a goal. I wanted to make the most of my physique and go to the top, win Mr. Olympia, and however long it took. You know, 1977 was already my, what was it? The years I competed, 72, 74, 75. It was my fifth try for Olympian 77. So 5, 6, and 7 were the magic years for me, 77, 78, 79. And, but, you know, it was all because my training conditions continued to improve. That was my goal. I knew that to get to the top, I'd have to have impeccable conditions for training. Everything had to be perfect, and it was.
But Frank had class in his physique.
In 1977, winning the Olympia meant a cash prize of $5,000 and the trophy which I got to learn later was the first year they gave out the Sandow Trophy. And so I'm the recipient of that, but I didn't know it at the time. And then, you know, winning it two more years after that, the prize money went up. It doubled each year.
Joe Weider will tell you, Joe and Betty Weider, you know, everybody thinks in the 70s, Arnold was on the cover a lot, Zane was on the cover a lot, and most people think, oh, the Arnold covers would have sold more. Joe says, no, Frank was always the one who sold more. Until Arnold became a film star and everything, and that went to a different audience. He could have been the icon Joe was looking for if he'd have been the personality of Arnold, but that wasn't him, you know.
In one decade, bodybuilding had skyrocketed from a growing sport to a booming industry. Fast on the heels of such unprecedented exposure came an age of rampant controversy, starting with the 1980 Mr. Olympia.
That was the victory that Arnold, last Olympia victory of Arnold in 1980, which was hugely controversial.
I've spoken to Arnold about that, and he's told me, you know, this is in the past 2 years or so. He was a little bit annoyed. Two things happened. He was signed up to Conan the Barbarian, and it was supposed to start shooting in something like 79 or something. They delayed and delayed and delayed until shooting wasn't going to start till late 1980. So he'd streamlined his physique, but to get to be Conan, he started training again, started putting on size.
But he kind of like educated the public, like, I'm so active, I still got this physique, I'm doing a Conan movie, but you have to have an audio. And his audio was Fitness, it was a smart move he made. So I learned from that, because in the point of view, you want to stay in the game, being active, you don't want to lose your fan.
But he was also very irked by people like Mike Mensah, who sort of debunked Arnold's training theories. Arnold was a volume guy, trained six times a week, twice a day, 20 sets of body part. Mensah was trained four or five times a week, three sets of body part, you know, high intensity. And sort of, it really knocked, is a word we use in English, Arnold. He wanted to teach these guys a lesson, you know. So even Zane said to him, who was very friendly with, you know, you're making a comeback, aren't you? You're putting so much into it. No. He told everybody, no, I'm going to Australia to do commentary for CBS. You know, I'm not going to do it.
But what happened is I had an accident where I fell into my swimming pool and basically smashed my urethra and had internal bleed. You know, it was awful. I almost died. Went into shock. But I ended up going in the contest anyway. It was an error in judgment. I was encouraged by Arnold to go in. That was his ploy, was to get me. But basically, I think he was getting even for the year before, 79, when I won the Olympia then. I embarrassed him, apparently. He asked me, he said, when I was coming off stage with the trophy, he says, Frank, what's it like to win Olympia this year? I says, Arnold, it's even better than when I beat you for Mr. Universe. And that really, they aired that, and that really made him angry.
And Arnold said to him, Frank, it's not about friendship, it's about strategy. He didn't want Frank to get the extra incentive, say, oh, you know, I better put the pedal down on this. So he went to Australia, and everybody thinks he's there to do commentary. And then the night before the contest, he enters. And of course, that sent shudders through the bodybuilding world at the time. He went to the competitors' meeting, and this riled a few people up. You know, Sami Bin Hu said something, and Arnold argued with him.
And the comment was made about Mensah said something, and Arnold said something about Mensah's waist hanging out last year, and that's why he didn't win, because his waist is hanging out all the time. And at that, Mensah attacked him. He jumped Arnold. And some people pulled him off. Bill Pearl was one of them. And that was it, you know. This was hotheads going at it.
Well, it's interesting. Arnold came back and wasn't in his best shape. But like I said before, like Joe said, go back to your roots, because Arnold was used bodybuilding because he had the fitness world to back him up. And that was a good point, because I think if he came second or third, it really didn't matter, because he was already five-time Mr. Olympia, six-time. So he had a name.
And most people to this day say he shouldn't have won the contest.
I never heard Mike Mensah say he should have ever won the contest. I think the general consensus of everybody there was the fact that the end result was not acceptable, not only to the bodybuilders there, but to the audience as well.
But of course, the controversy of that contest was absolutely enormous.
CBS went to Sydney with a full film crew, and they filmed the whole thing. Immediately after the contest was over with, the guy that was the director was a guy by the name of Sherman Egan. And he called up, he said, I'd like to meet with you and Zane and Mensur. So we went to a meeting. He says, look, guys, he says, this Mr. Olympia contest can never be shown on television. He says, it's so obvious, even from the eyes of a non-professional, that the right person didn't win. We could never put this on television. So they still had a contract for 1981, and they paid the money because they were obligated, but they never even sent a film crew to cover it. And that's the last time the major networks have ever covered bodybuilding.
I wish I wouldn't gone in that year and went in the next year when Colombo went it. You know, that was a travesty. Come on, give it to anybody, huh? I mean, that could have been incredible that year. But I passed the following year for political reasons. We're already, everybody was mad at each other. So, you know, we didn't go back to compete that year in the Olympia.
The 1980 Mr. Olympia left a lot of people very bitter. And for maybe some egotistical reason, we decided that we were not going to enter the 1981 Mr. Olympia.
And Franco, who was always two steps behind Arnold, makes his comeback from a leg injury a few years before, when in the World's Strongest Man, he dropped a refrigerator on his leg and broke it. And he won that contest. Now, to most people, that was a bigger controversy than Arnold. You can see why Arnold could have won, but not many people can see why Franco was the winner. Once again, Chris Dickerson had to settle for second place.
I said, what happened in Sydney could never happen in the United States. Well, I was totally wrong, because the same thing happened again in 81. But people only choose to remember 1980. You'd have to go back and really, because I didn't go to the contest. I kept my word. But you'd have to ask people like Danny Padilla, Chris Dickerson, Roy Callender, Tom Platz, how they felt about it. Because they must have really been discouraged after repeating the same thing the year before.
The dust gradually settled. 1982 saw Chris Dickerson become the first African-American to win the Mr. Olympia after more than a decade of competing. The following year, Samir Banu, the Lion of Lebanon, claimed his Mr. Olympia victory.
1983 in Munich, Samir Banu always got tremendous shape, massive arms, great back, but always held water. In 82, in my opinion, he was fourth. He could have won because he'd got rid of the water. He'd learned how to get the water out of his system.
I mean, at the very least, I felt that the show was between me and Chris Dickerson.
82, I went to London bigger than ever for the Olympian. Dickerson won. I was a little bit too big, maybe.
My feeling is first or second would have been much fairer than coming in fourth. So, yeah, I made up my mind since I peaked properly for the 82, I decided to go to Germany for the 1983. Miss Olympia was held in Munich. I left early, 6 weeks prior to the show. I did my homework. I even was more focused because I want this thing so bad, you know.
So here I'm preparing for the first go-round, man, and I peaked at 243 pounds. I entered the show at 233 pounds, the same weight I won the IFBB World Championship. So what happened to the 10 pounds? What happened?
Yeah, I put myself through, a tough preparation, and good enough, we managed to win it. We got it done.
He came out, and he had a Christmas tree back that like nobody had ever seen before, massive arms. And he won the contest.
I went into that show. I placed third. You know, Samir won it that year. And I think Muhammad Makawi took second. I took third. Frank Zane took fourth.
And already I could see the tide turning, you know, as Lee Haney placing third ahead of me and Samir winning it, you know. I figured, well, this is it. I got to retire sometime, you know. Now is it. I'm in great shape. I'm going out looking my best. So that was the last show.
I think being Mr. Olympia for Sammy, he had to travel a lot. He he wasn't as prepared for 1984 as he was the previous year. And I don't think anybody was prepared for Lee Haney.
Lee Haney came along with a combination of size and good aesthetics. There was nothing blocky about Lee. He had a great shape. And part of that, by the way, is because I always describe him as a guy with mastodon muscles but not mastodon bones. Haney got into bodybuilding because he broke his leg twice playing high school football. That is, he had this massive muscle structure, but his bones were and joints were smaller. That's how come he got the taper.
Because I knew when I peaked at 243, with symmetry, balance, with the look of Robbie, with the look of Arnold, and a posing routine like a Frank Zane, but you know, with the movement of Frank Zane or Ed Corning, then that was a winning combination. So that's what I worked upon achieving in 1984. And as I prepared for that competition, I prepared like never before.
Lee Haney took notice to me because he saw that I trained so hard. And Lee Haney came up to me, he goes, hey, you know, I'm getting ready to go into the Olympia. Would you like to train with me?
He was the most intense guy that I've ever trained with. I mean, intense in every sense of the word. You know, Rich would leave it all in the gym when he trained. I mean, foaming at the mouth, drooling the whole nine yards. That's how Rich was.
And then what was even better is then I went with Lee Haney into New York for his first Mr. Olympia win, and he won that show. And it was just one of the greatest experiences. I turned pro, and my good friend ended up winning Mr. Olympia.
All of that came together at that 1984 Mr. Olympia. When they raised my arms in victory, man, I felt I was on top of the world then. And I knelt down on stage and I thanked God for what he had done and what he had allowed me to do.
You know, I'm this 21-year-old cocky kid thinking, man, I can go right into the Mr. Olympia, you know, and win the show. And I still knew there was Lee Haney, this Lee Haney who's just, at that time, was a freak, real wide clavicle, little waist, you know, huge back, thick chest.
Rich Gaspari, he was responsible for a certain evolution of bodybuilding until he came along as a pro, made his pro debut in 85, his Olympia debut in 85, and got third. He was 22 years old.
And now I'm this kid, you know, 22 years old, coming in third place, and I was like a bit disappointed, and people are like, what are you, crazy? You're 22 years old, your first Mr. Olympia, you come in third place in that show. So I was like, wow, this is easy. I'm just going to do it again, and I'm going to win the next year. And it just never came out that way.
Nobody ever seen that hardness, vascularity, and the ripped glutes. This was a new thing.
I brought something different to the sport that no one else had at that time, and that was striated glutes. I was known for my butt for being the hardest, you know, hardest bodybuilder at that time. So I set this standard in the sport, and then going into the Mr. Olympia, I became one of the favorites now.
It's amazing. Each year brought about something different or another different turn in my life because, as you know, I was a father as I trained for the Mr. Olympia competitions.
And then there was all talk in the magazines that Rich is favorite to win. Rich can beat Lee Haney. And in my mind at that time, it's like, you know what? Maybe I can beat Lee Haney. Even though he was like this guy, my great bodybuilder. Now, mind you, just to remember, we were living in California together. Now we both moved. I moved back to New Jersey. He moved to Atlanta. We still communicated and talked. We were friends, but I was very competitive. And as a friend, I still wanted to beat him.
I've always looked at my training for a Mr. Olympia competition, even as the NPC Nationals competition, as my job. I'm going to work, and when I'm at work, give my very best. Don't have slack on anything, because I've been taught that, to work as though I'm working unto God. And if you're working for the master, then you're going to give your all every time around.
And I wanted to make a year's worth of gains, because I figured if I didn't compete, that I was going to get better and go into the 1987 Olympia and win. And that ended up not being true until 1988. I come in second again. Probably the best condition that I could be in, but again, it wasn't enough to beat Lee Haney. But then there was another bodybuilder, and it was Lee Labrada. He was known for his, you know, symmetry and structure and, you know, the mass with class.
You know, entering the pro ranks at 175 pounds can be a daunting challenge for anybody.
Lee Labrada came along at the same time, And there was certain aspect. Lee had great proportions, could present himself well, very polished, big arms for a little guy.
You know, in 89, I mounted a serious challenge to Haney for the first time. But I came in a solid second. And I was a crowd favorite because we were competing in Rimini, Italy at the time. And of course, the Italians have an eye for aesthetic physiques, you know, with the Roman heritage and that type of thing. So I was very popular there.
And you had Sonny Smith, Vince Taylor, a lot of great champions, Lita Brada. I think Rich, I called him Rich the Itch, never would go away.
Coming from second and now dropping to second and then losing to Lee Labrada and Vince Taylor, and Lee Haney again won the show.
And I geared up for 1990, and I thought that was going to be my year because that was the year that they had the drug testing, and I knew that that with you know my natural genetics and the like that I would be able to put on a very strong showing, and I got to tell you that what was running through my mind as came down to the wire, and the announcer said, and the winner is Lee. Because we're both Lees, it was like a feeling of being like at the edge of a cliff, and I got to tell you that I was either going to jump off and soar, or I was going to fall to the bottom and crash, and it was the feeling of a free fall when Haney's name was called for first place.
But again, it was the size factor that Haney had. It was like, well, you can beat me on that, but take that, you know, and it went like that. And Labrada came very close to toppling Haney, you know, in Rimini in Italy and in 1990, which was the drug-tested contest. But it was not to be, you know. And again, Lee Labrada would have been a magnificent Mr. Olympia in personality and bearing.
I was very young as a bodybuilder, and I started seeing things happen to me. I started getting injuries and actually almost going into, like, a burnout, you know, with competing. Going into then the 1990 Mr. Olympia, I ended up getting fifth place in that show. So I dropped another place, and I was like, oh, my God, I'm done, you know, in bodybuilding.
You got to feel sorry for Rich, because if Lee Haney had never existed, he'd have been at least a three-time Mr. Olympia, because he was second three times in a row. At a phenomenally, you know, most pros today, well, they're not turning pro until the 30, and he was doing this at 22, 23, 24, you know. And you know, he was another magnificent guy.
I talked to Cheryl. I said, baby, you know, I've done seven Olympias in a row. No one has ever done seven in a row. And I said to her, well, what do you think about that being, you know, it? Being a competitor, Shirley is. She looked at me and said, it. What do you mean, it? She said, you got to do eight. What are you talking about? Let's only have this conversation anymore. That's my wife. And so that gave me enough zeal and fire to go on to do that eighth Olympia.
But along came a guy who was equal in size and poundage and had good shape. Everybody decries Dorian Yates' shape, but he's got the shape. He's got the proportions. You know, there's no long torso or short legs, or he's got the back and everything. And Lee Haney knew he was a threat.
And if you're looking to knock out a titan, you got to have a guy, at least in my mind, you got to have another Titan.
And they went at it in Orlando in 91. The symmetry round, Lee Haney won. The muscularity round, Dorian won.
I think, I don't know if it's the first time, I haven't seen it since, where there's just a two-man pose down. It was Dorian Yates and Lee Haney, and I was the first guy to go on stage to have the stature and the body weight to stand next to Lee Haney. And I enjoyed being the underdog.
And the crowd was going nuts, these two big guys. Nobody had seen 245, 250-pound guys, two of them going at it in condition, you know. And it took 4.5 minutes, because I timed it, for them to do the then seven compulsory poses, and they gave everything, you know.
You couldn't be beat. That was my mindset. That's what I worked on my entire career. And it all came together when I chose the music Excalibur. That was the return of the king.
In 1984, his first Mr. Olympia, he posed the theme from Excalibur. And so the certain symmetry took place, because his last contest, he posed to Excalibur again. Gave this magnificent performance, and of course won the posing round.
So I went into that competition in perfect peace. At the end of the night, my arms were raised in victory.
and he took home the eighth Sandow, and that was the end of his competitive days. And Lee Haney, I think if you had to say who was the first gentleman of bodybuilding, who is the greatest ambassador we ever had and still have, it's Lee Haney.
A new age of self-awareness had hit the bodybuilding industry at the turn of the 1990s. Industry leaders sought a presence at the Olympic Games. The innocence of years gone by started to erode as athletes began submitting themselves to drug tests.
Well, I think the feeling was that there needed to be drug testing because, there was a hope. Ben Weider wanted to get bodybuilding into the Olympics, so we had to sort of approach IOC standards in drug testing.
We all got notified that they were going to be instituting a drug test in, I believe, like October.
So that was introduced for the first time at the 1990 Arnold Classic.
I won the Arnold Classic Championships, and a week later I wound up in Columbus, Ohio, and I won the competition with perfect scores, $60,000. Mike Ashley had gotten second place there. Mike Christian was third. And I went on a tour of Canada, and while I was there, I got a call from Wayne D'Amelio a week later that my drug test had came back positive, and I have an opportunity to check sample B in either in Westwood, Los Angeles, or in Chicago. However, I was on tour, and I couldn't do anything about it.
NBC filmed it. They had to re-edit it. They were showing it at a later date. Mike Ashley was the winner. Very clunky.
So my next call was obviously to Joe Weider, like, what do I do here? I mean, this is a time when they didn't have the internet. They didn't have Twitter. They didn't have Facebook. They didn't have cell phones where you could text message stuff. So there's 4,000 people that were in Columbus, Ohio, that wouldn't be notified of this information for nearly 3 months. And Joe Weider had just said, basically, Sean, stay on your game, do what you have to do. You're one of our, most highly decorated athletes. We are going to support you and prove them wrong in Chicago in 1990. So it was about 8 months I had between losing 60,000 and watching the Arnold Classic Championship go right through my hands to trying to get redemption in Chicago.
So the 1990 Mr. Olympia was going to be drug tested, so they decided to test all the guys before so you'd know who'd failed on Friday, so we wouldn't have the embarrassment of taking the trophy off somebody.
Was I baffled by the test results? Of course I was. I didn't think I would test positive because, based on the athletes talking amongst each other, certain drugs work certain ways and they're faster acting and they're, in and out of your system. And, of course, none of us knew how to pass a test. And that was never my goal either. But, of course, I didn't argue it. I didn't try to fight it. I just went back to the gym. I went back to the gym. But I knew I had to work even harder because I had 8 months and I had a legend I was going up against in Chicago in the form of Lee Haney.
So Friday night, out came the results. And favorites like Momo Benazizer and Barry DeMay had failed. And Van Walcott Smith and Vince Comeff had failed. So two of the top names were out of the Olympia, Come the day of the contest, Saturday afternoon, all the guys that were left in walked out. And it was immediately obvious that all of them were down in size. Lee Haney, Sean, I've always told Sean this, the legs were still there, but the upper body just didn't have that density. There was three guys who looked the same as they always did. That was Mike Christian, Francis Benfatto, and Frank Hillebrand. Everybody else was down a bit. Lee Labrada, Gaspari, all of them were down. But then another thing happened. Vince McMahon launched his World Bodybuilding Federation. He said he was going to just do a magazine, and he had a booth at the Olympia. But at the conclusion of this Olympia, his guys, Tom Platz and others, went round handing out, announcing the new federation, the WBF, the World Bodybuilding Federation.
When he was doing very well with professional wrestling and decided he would try his hand at bodybuilding,
it sent earthquakes through the whole bodybuilding landscape. Everybody thought McMahon, with all his money and everything, this is going to happen. And suddenly we knew who was in there, the likes of Strider, DeMay, Quinn, Mike Chris, really big hitters that were top six finishers in the Olympia every time they were in it. Mike Quinn was there.
Vince McMahon had just entered into bodybuilding and was coming along with the WBF, a new federation. offering more money, and he secured, like, you know, 13 bodybuilders away from the IFBB, which made some things a little bit easier for some bodybuilders that were in the IFBB, because he took a few good guys.
The amount of money they were offered was enormous. I think Barry was getting $300,000 a year. This is back in 1990. And even somebody like Lee Haney's contract with Weider would probably be 40 or 50 grand at that time. So it was enormous. But Barry said, you know, and this goes back to what I said before, the drive is always to be the best in the world. He said, we all realized we weren't going to be the best in the world. We were going to be the best in this little group. We weren't going to beat Lee Haney. And somehow the drive went out of it, you know, and some of the guys were far from the best.
I think what knocked the legs out from Vince McMahon was the scandal he had with the steroids.
And I think he decided that, you know, bodybuilding with its, you know, the slur of drugs, it had been an experiment that he'd gone into with a good heart, but it was time to be strategic and, you know, concentrate on what he knew best. And that was the end of the WBF.
Had he had some good management, I mean, what makes you extremely professional, that formula that works so well in wrestling, ain't going to work in bodybuilding. And he applied that same formula, and it didn't work. If he would have just listened to some people, he wouldn't have wasted money, and he could have made a big dent. It might have been different, but he was the one that forced Joe to start offering contracts, because then eventually he became afraid he would lose everybody.
He did call up Ben and Joe Weider after it folded and said, you know, I'm done. You know, you guys know what you're doing more than I do in this sphere, and good luck and no hard feelings. So, you know, there was no rancor in the end there.
While the industry dealt with its various troubles, the competitive standard set by Lee Haney was about to be shattered by the new juggernaut of the 90s, Dorian Yates.
And then along came Dorian Yates from England, who won the Mr. Olympia 6 times and just brought a whole new standard of hardness and freakiness. And, you know, to me, the golden age of bodybuilding was the 90s, you know. I think after that, you know, Yates is often blamed for taking the sport in the wrong direction. But what he was doing what he knew he had to do to win. And hardness and mass seemed to be the criteria, the calling cards.
You know, so you had the, you know, the more symmetrical and classical type physiques like Sean Ray, Lee Labrada, you had Barry DeMay, you know, you had a number of guys that were threatening that standard, okay, but that was squelched. Again, we were at a crossroads, and the crossroads went the other way. Again, back to the past, to the large bodybuilder in the incarnation of Dorian Yates this time, and it has never looked back.
You know what? If I can get past Labrada, Haney doesn't have much longer to go. I could potentially become Mr. Olympia, and it became very real to me in 1990, getting third in that Olympia, that I would one day become Mr. Olympia, because there's no way Lee Haney can last that much longer. Unfortunately for me, I didn't see the shadow coming, Dorian Yates by way of England.
When I turned pro, I don't think I was seriously thinking about being Mr. Olympia. I just wanted to be a good pro, and that's as far as my thinking was going at that time. So I was the first European bodybuilder to win Mr. Olympia, and also training at the time in Europe.
Dorian Yates was able to dominate bodybuilding in the 90s. Because he was bigger and thicker than anybody else. Plus, he was aesthetic, as I say. He was Herculean, not Apollonian. So he didn't have a pretty, shapely physique, but it was balanced and artistic and sculptural.
The evolution of bodybuilding changed when Dorian came into the scene, because he was one of the first bodybuilders to compete at like 260, 265. So he set this like freakiness to the sport.
Well, in 1992, of course, Dorian Yates won his first Mr. Olympia in Helsinki, Finland.
Mr. Olympia was wide open that year. I'll never forget it. It was wide open in 1992. Ferrigno was coming back, and he was you know, competing over 300 pounds.
Part of me said, what am I doing here? I'm standing here competing. Am I out of my mind? I'm 42 years old. These guys like Sean Ray, these guys like, you know, Milo Savage and everything, they're like in their 20s. But then I realized that I got a lot of work to do, because after coming back for 17 years, you need a couple of years training under your belt. And I got a lot to learn, because the hardest thing for me was the posing. All you guys are standing there with the app tense and relaxed. I was basically just saying, like, in the 70s, kind of like semi-relaxed. And people kept yelling, the audience, pose, pose, tense. And it was very foreign to me, but I knew I had a lot of work to do.
To be honest, it was a little bit hard for me that year, because I didn't have any one person to focus on. I got to beat this guy. You know, there was a whole bunch of guys that could have possibly won the title. So it was a little bit hard. And also, it's a barrier to get over. Could it really be me? Could I be the best in the world at my chosen sport? There was that barrier, and then eventually I got over that. Like, why the hell not? You know, it's got to be somebody, and I don't think anyone's training harder than me. And I always had that inside of me, like, I don't think anyone could have done any more. So that gives you a lot of strength.
They called me second, and it was a relief. It was a joyful moment. It was a celebration for me, because at that point I knew that I had obviously probably earned a spot to be there. Never really questioned myself if I should be there or not, but I knew at that point I have a responsibility to do, and that was to move forward and to be better.
I went on to have to watch the big side, phrases like gargantuan and mass monsters come, was being ushered in. Paul Dillette came onto the scene. Achim Albrecht was coming into the fray. Jean-Pierre Fuchs. All these big six-foot bodybuilders were coming in, making a big impact on the industry. And this is where I think bodybuilding started to change.
93 was a great year where I made a leap forward in physique development and body weight on stage nobody had seen before. That was great.
Dorian Yates showed up in 93, a transformed bodybuilder that was unbeatable. Dorian was taking bodybuilding to a whole new level of, you know, impression. I mean, people were just getting overwhelmed with this size.
I was the first guy to compete at the Mr. Olympia, I think, in condition over 250 pounds. But I had this drive, and I had this system of high-intensity, heavy training, which had gotten me from a backstreet basement gym in Birmingham in England to be Mr. Olympia. So it's, you know, once your foot's on the pedal, on the gas, it's a little bit hard to take it off.
1994 came along, and I got first runner-up in the Mr. Olympia Championships, my first time in that position. And this is when Dorian tore his bicep and came in a little bit heavy and bloated around the midsection.
I was very stubborn. I wanted to train, as you know, all year round, just as heavy as I did in the off-season coming up for a contest, which was not the best idea. I think I was doing bent over rows with like 440 or something like that, 6 weeks out from the contest, and there was a bang and a sharp pain in my left bicep. So obviously there was a serious injury. There was damage there.
I think a lot of people, you know, you could flip a coin on who you talk to and what they liked, had me winning that contest. Whereas Dorian felt in certain poses, he won enough poses to win the competition. I can't take that away from him, because clearly he was bigger. Clearly he was more dominant, more imposing figure. I mean, he brought all that stuff.
97, he had a quad injury early on in the year, and then another one, and then 3 weeks before the contest.
I had some advice, which probably now is not good advice. I had a cortisone injection in that tendon, which of course takes the inflammation away, but also weakens the tendon. And I did ease up a little bit on the training, and 3 weeks out, I was doing a tricep exercise, not particularly heavy, and bang. There was a really intense, sharp pain and a noise, and I knew it was a serious injury.
I was out in the garden, the phone rang. It's 6 o'clock in Santa Monica, it's 2 o'clock in England. And my wife Anne says, Dorian's on the phone, 2 o'clock in the morning. Well, this isn't good.
Again, it was difficult, and psychologically it's very hard going into a contest when you're not going in all guns blazing. But I managed to pull off that win.
He still wanted to get it repaired and come back the next year, but in the end he got it repaired, it never came back, he couldn't handle the weights.
I couldn't train 100%, so that was a message. You want to compete the best in the world, you can't do that unless you're training 100%. So that was a time for me to retire. It wasn't something that I prepared for or considered. It was something that was more or less forced upon me, but, you know, maybe it's a good thing.
And he pushed his body to the point where he tore it apart over several years. At the end of his career, he just had all kinds of damage to his body because you cannot push yourself that hard. and not have the body give way. But in the meantime, he was able to get a level of development and a thickness and a hardness that the other guys couldn't get.
And, you know, that was his reign over. You know, he'd won six.
I got to say the 90s is probably the most competitive period in bodybuilding as far as the depth of quality of physique and talent that were there. You got six or seven guys there that are very, very close competitively that could interchange at any point depending on what condition the guys came in. So I would say definitely that was the most intense period. So whether I won three, four, five, six Mr. Olympias, it would still be a great achievement with the people I was competing against.
When Yates gracefully retired in 1997, the torch was passed to another born champion who changed bodybuilding for good, Ronnie Coleman.
Today I go to the gym, and Brian Dobson is the owner. He's like, man, he see me come in, he's like, man, you compete? I'm like, no. Say, you ever competed? I'm like, no. Like, pretty big, you probably need to compete. You could probably be world champion one day. And as soon as he said that, first thing out of my mouth was, no thank you. Now, I'm not into bodybuilding. I haven't even picked up a bodybuilding magazine. I don't know nothing about what's going on in that sport. I'm very unconcerned. It's just like something foreign to me. You didn't ask me that every day I come in. Every day I tell you no, so I'm still going to have to, you know, decline the offer. He's like, I'm telling you, you need to do this. He's like, I tell you what. He said, there's a contest coming up in about 3-4 months. He's like, if you compete in this show, I give you a free membership to the gym. And remember, I'm struggling, so anytime somebody offers you something free at a time like that, you're like, okay, what I got to do?
Nobody's had a slower climb up the ladder, you know. Made his pro debut in 92 at the Olympia, didn't finish in the top 15, was a journeyman pro, in and out.
And I can remember it like it was yesterday, because I remember I was backstage pumping up, and I look over, and it's Sean Ray's over there. He's doing push-ups on the wall, and the first thing I see is this big old chest sticking out while all these striations and stuff are going. I'm like, man, I'm in the wrong sport. I placed dead last in that show.
98 became his breakthrough year in a big way. At the end of 97, there were 7 Grand Prix in Europe, and Kevin Lerone won the first 6. And then, sensationally, Ronnie beat Kevin. Kevin was a fantastic bodybuilder. He won that last one, and that was a sign, you know. Because then, in 98, he won the San Francisco show, or him and Lerone went in 3 shows in May, New York, San Francisco, and in Canada, Montreal or something. And Ronnie won 2, Lerone won 1.
4 or 5 months after that, in September, and I was faced with, at that point, the Olympia was wide open.
And Plex was the favorite. But even then, you know, you could see Flex's back double biceps is a thing of beauty. But the only guy in that lineup of that time, Lerone, Sean, Nasser, that could match him on double biceps, not beat him, but not be vanquished by him, was Ronnie.
So we come down to Mr. Olympia. I'm like, man, if I can make the top 3, this will be more better than a dream come true, you know, because I know I never win, because, like I said, I just got into sport just to keep my free membership to the gym.
The Olympia was what I wanted in 1998 because Dorian Yates had retired. He'd gotten injured. I'd sat behind him for 6 years. I'd watched the tail end of the Lee Haney era. And lo and behold, me, Kevin, and Flex see Ronnie Coleman, a guy that we used to not even pay attention to, leapfrog over all of us.
So come the day of the show in New York, 1998, Mr. Olympia, Madison Square Garden, great crowd. They walk out. And Ronnie is ripped to shreds. He's as hard. He's maybe a bit down in fullness, but he's as hard as a rock. In fact, he looked almost gray to me, and at one point I thought, he's going to pass out. He was right on the edge. Flex was just a little bit off. Still, Flex took the prejudging, but Ronnie came back in the evening and took the title.
You know, leading up to the show, everybody already gave it to Flex, so I'm like, okay, at least I got a second, so I'm still just as happy as I can ever be. So all of a sudden, Wayne calls out Flex Wheeler's name for second. I'm like, did I just hear that right? And I'm like, yeah. And the first thing I did was collapse.
Ronnie became, from this quiet, slow burn guy in the background who nobody ever thought of being a threat to anything. He loved being Mr. Olympia. And 1999, he came back, maybe not as hard as 98, but fuller. And he was like a walking anatomy chart, you know. And he just dominated on size. You know, he just got bigger and bigger.
My heavy was with 04 when I was 296 on the Olympia stage.
I saw the writing on the wall with Ronnie Coleman coming in at 280, 275, 290 pounds, that bodybuilding and the landscape was forever changed.
The size just blew everybody away, you know. Jay Cutler was in it, but there was no contest that time. You know, Ronnie was just an amalgam of muscle that, you know, a freak of nature that, you know, we won't see for a long time.
Ronnie Coleman reigned supreme until 2005, tying Lee Haney's 8 Mr. Olympia wins. Coleman even won 4 Mr. Olympia contests over the man who would, in time, come to eclipse him, Jay Cutler.
You know, I always wanted to be somebody. I picked up a magazine when I was 12 years old. I saw a picture of Chris Dickerson and my sister's boyfriend. He had some old magazines laying around, and I was just overwhelmed by what the body could look like. I couldn't believe it. You know, I had seen superheroes before, you know, in Batman and Superman in cartoons, but I never saw in real life a physique look like that. And I just, you know, I marveled at it. I just couldn't believe that this was actually attainable. So here I am from small town USA. My dream is to always go to California and train amongst, you know, the pros that I read about in the magazines, but it can be possible because these other guys did it.
In 2001, Jay Cutler nearly beat Ronnie, but after that, Ronnie, you know, reeled off another few victories.
I knew then that I had something that I could battle Ronnie with, and that was really what drove me into 2001, where I was a much better athlete coming into Mr. Olympia. I took the whole year to prepare. Now I have the fans behind me because now I was an underdog, and I was happy. I was ecstatic to be second place. That was almost as great as winning to me, because I was really competitive, and a lot of people thought Jay should win this competition.
So Jay was always finishing second, apart from 2002 when he didn't compete in the Olympia. In 2005, it was very, very close. Personally, I would have given it to Jay, and Jay was absolutely devastated by it.
So I felt in 2005, I matched Ronnie Coleman, like, in a lot of poses, including some back shots, which I never thought I did. I improved a little bit there, and he still was definitely at a different level.
But in 2006, he finally beat Ronnie.
When we were building up for the competition, you know, of course, it became a Ronnie and Jay show after all these years, after being second, you know, 4 times in a row. Of course, it was almost like Ronnie Coleman, Jay Cutler, Mr. Olympia. So when I won and knocked off the champ, which he was going for his record 9th Mr. Olympia, he had already won 8. It was a huge, huge monkey off my back.
And of course, after that, Jay won in 2007, and some people thought Martinez had won, and then Jay lost in 2008 to Dexter, and it seemed that Jay, it was over for Jay.
Going back and looking at Jay from the previous years, you know, each year he was getting, you know, he wasn't getting much better than he was the previous year, so he was getting worse and worse. I said, well, you know, I think I can beat Jay. You know, so my trainer at the time, Joe McNeil, and I, we put our heads together, came up with a game plan, man, and we went into the Olympia, you know, full steam ahead. I just knew I could beat him that show. I knew he wasn't going to be on because he's trying to play. You know, after me winning the Arnold and all that stuff, it was the battle between me and Jay. So I knew he was going to try and play my game. So that's how I beat him in the GNC show of strength, because he tried to play my game and tried to get shredded and come down and he lost a lot of weight and tried to get just as hard as me. And that's how they would beat him then. Well, I knew he was going to do the same thing for the Arnold in Olympia in 2008, which he did. And I was able to pull it off.
And Dexter did win it deservedly. Dexter, you know, was shredded, had great shape and fullness, had got all the body parts, you know. Jay was a bit off, so it was Dexter's year, and he won deservedly.
But when I won Mr. Olympia, I can't really put in words how I was feeling, because it took me 6 months to even acknowledge that I'm Mr. Olympia now. I mean, that really took me that long. You know, people would come up to me and they would be like,
How are you, Mr. Olympia? It's like, man, I'm Dexter, you know what I'm saying? So it took forever for me to accept that name and that title. So to actually win and be on stage and just everything came out, all the dreams and everything that you can imagine that you went through in life, you know, all the sleeping on the floors and all that stuff. I put my family through, all that stuff came out on stage that day, man, to win that title. So it was like, I won this title. That's what I sacrificed, you know, to get here.
And then he reinvented himself in 2009. When he walked out, it was like, wow.
I can't really fear any of that, and I can't fear losing because I've already lost the title and won it back, and I was the first guy to do that. And, you know, I'm only thinking victory.
And he just rewrote the record books with that type of physique and then took it again in 2010.
Never really been a goal to be that all-time winner. I never thought one was attainable. Now I got two, three, four.
Jay, I have tremendous respect for Jay, you know, on so many levels. He's like a great bodybuilder. I don't think I've shot anyone that wide as Jay. I mean, you know, he was a true freak of his time.
This is what established, you know, Jay Cutler. This is who I am. And I fell in love with this iron game for so many years ago when I mentioned I was 12 years old. And now, look what I've achieved. I've become the best in the world at something. That's everyone's dream.
With the transition into another decade, one massive king gives way to another. One whose talents have a decidedly gifted future for bodybuilding.
You know, although I didn't have as many struggles in the amateur ranks, I definitely felt that, you know, I had to learn quite a bit being a professional, because I wasn't being embraced by all the other guys, because they're saying, well, who this punk kid? He only competed for 2 years and he's pro and he's on the magazines, he's got sponsorships. You know, it just taught me that the only way I was going to earn the respect and the love was to compete at a high level, and that's just what I did, and I made sure of that. You know, I was very confident because I just knew in my heart that I'm going to shock the world. You know, I just remember Jay shaking my hand and just saying, you're the king now. And when he said that, I just realized, you know what? He's right. If I believe in it, he's right. If I don't believe in it, anything can happen. I could lose this thing next year. I truly feel that my type of physique is going to recharge the sport a little bit. I think my physique is still growing at the age of 31. So who knows how big I may get. But at the same time, I mean, I'm not stupid. I know what got me the Mr. Olympia title. It wasn't trying to outmass anyone. It was about being more aesthetic, but yet having the muscles round, like very cartoonish, and having sharp conditioning to make those muscles stand out even larger than life.
I think after we watched Phil Heath win this Mr. Olympia in 2001, one thing is sure, bodybuilding is alive and well.
You know, I look at Phil and I think about myself, I think about Sean Ray, I think about, you know, Flex Wheeler, I think about size with class, mass. Sean used to say that all the time, you know, I think about Lee Labrada, I think about, you know, Gaspare, the cuts, you know, everything. He ties it all in together. I think today, where we are right now, you know, he's certainly a good champion for the sport.
Fear brings a different type of flavor, one that sort of takes a little step back from the monstrous physique to more balanced size and symmetry, which that's where I'm from, so that's what I like.
And I'm happy Phil Heath won because, to me, he has a beautiful body, this aesthetic. And I hate to see the sport get to a point that we're sacrificing symmetry.
In the course of just over a century, what was once a sideshow attraction had developed into a new way of life for millions around the world. Men who brought discipline, scientific expertise, and unrelenting dedication have inspired each successive generation to studiously build upon their achievements. Bodybuilding as a sport has as much to offer its competitors in return as they are willing to dedicate of themselves. Like the training regimes, business practices, and the athletes, bodybuilding will always be changing. It will never cease to evolve.
A lot of sports have evolved. You know, we use the term evolution here. What I described before, going from Eugene Sandow to Yates and guys who came after. That was evolution. But evolution usually means, you know, a process of improvement. And I'm not sure. In many ways, I think the evolution of bodybuilding has peaked with the 90s, and we're not going forward with creating a, you know, the perfect human specimen.
I think the guys now are generally bigger, but the conditioning is not as keen as it was in the 90s. So yes, the bodybuilders are bigger. Are they better? Not necessarily, I don't think.
You're talking about 18 almost consecutive wins, you know, almost two decades of champions, Olympian champions, that were freaks, you know. And it seemed that the fans like the freaks, you know. They like the, you know, even to this very day, you know, the freaks sell, you know. Dorian sells, Ronnie sells, Jay sells. So over that 20-year period, could it have been different? Possibly. Just think, Sean, if you won Mr. Olympia, or Kevin won Mr. Olympia, or Flex won Mr. Olympia, how things may have changed the tide.
It's more of a freak factor nowadays. And I think the whole society is changing towards that. How photography is today, if you look in at any bodybuilding magazine, and it's a natural evolution with how the physiques looks today. It's all about shooting big, big, big weights, you know, huge muscles, using like wide angles used to enhance it. So I shoot differently. Before, I could use like a long, like a telephoto lens, you know, to shoot everything, because it makes everything in proportion, like the eye sees it, or a little bit more compressed maybe. And now you know, we use a lot of wide angle lenses used to make an arm look super big, because that's what the latest fashion is somehow.
The youngsters that are getting into this sport look at the magazines, they look at the bodybuilders that are at the top now, and they realize that to get there, they're going to have to do things that they don't want to do.
I look at where it is now, it is a little bit different from my eyes. You know, golly, man, I like a 63 Chevy. You know, I got to send a 4 Corvette. I think I'm cool. But, you know, things change.
I hear all the time people complaining that the bodybuilders are too big. And I don't think they're too big at all. I think they're just heavyweights or super heavyweights. The problem is that the smaller bodybuilders just don't get enough recognition because there aren't weight divisions in the pros. There are in the amateurs. Bodybuilding is not supposed to be about mass. It is supposed to be about sculptural perfection. And if you have a guy who's 5'9", 225 pounds, absolutely perfect, he shouldn't be standing next to somebody who's 295 pounds, any more than the middleweight boxer should be forced to fight the heavyweight boxer. Weight divisions restore the aesthetic quality to bodybuilding.
It's hard to say if we're heading in the right direction. It's just the evolution. It's going to get there anyway. I think the evolution of bodybuilding is along several lines. I think it's evolution in some sense, like nutritional supplements and awareness and what's available and what's known about it now. The science of longevity, that as well. Equipment design and the quality of equipment and just what's known about training methods and all the stuff. There's more tools available now than ever before.
I think that pro bodybuilding is going to come back to a state where physiques are more attractive from a classical sense. You know, I think that we're going to come full circle.
I always feel that bodybuilding is going to be there. I'm not sure if God bodybuilders are going to get to the 300-pound mark. They probably will. And they're probably going to have bigger prize monies. But it's still going to be kind of like this different type of cultish kind of sport, but I still think it's always going to be there for the future.
I just loved what was happening. I felt proud that I was doing something worthwhile, but I couldn't afford to make a single mistake.
Where we are here today in the evolution, I think it's bodybuilding is positioned right now the strongest that it's ever been in the history.
Just as bodybuilding has evolved from, and as most things evolve, starting with the core and then having a broader group of people become interested in that, but maybe not aspire to that exact same level of intensity. And so it tends to naturally evolve. And that's what I think you see in the Olympia. I think it's a very healthy evolution. The more people that can participate as participants and as spectators, the better. And I think that's what you see with the Olympia right now.
Even though bodybuilding has evolved with certain, you know, physique changes and a lot more money is around than it was before, Arnold and those guys, Larry Scott, it didn't justify a living for them. Today, you guys can have a career out of it.
Prize money has grown by leaps and bounds since those early years. I mean, for example, 1970, Arnold Schwarzenegger won. The total purse was $1,000. Today, we have $815,000 as the total purse, which includes men's bodybuilding, women's bodybuilding, fitness, figure, and now bikini, with $200,000 being the grand prize for that men, the overall men's winner. So, I mean, just when you look at prize money alone, it's an enormous increase. I mean, and what that means is that people are able to make a living and earn a living as professional bodybuilders. They don't need to have part-time jobs. They don't need to have full-time jobs.
Bodybuilding in the early years, the athletes were required to work jobs because they didn't have the support of the sponsors and the prize money wasn't so valued. There wasn't so many bodybuilding competitions. Nowadays, we have so many bodybuilding competitions where the athletes can compete. They can qualify for the Mr. Olympia. They can be contracted by companies because the exposure is much more of an advantage, having not only magazines themselves, but the internet has become so huge in the marketing perspective.
It has evolved into something so awesome that I don't know where it's going, but it can only go up exponentially because of technology. I mean, now we're having video conferencing through businesses. Well, don't you think that at some point in time, a bodybuilder like myself may take one of my phones and use a Wi-Fi network and say, hey, this is what I'm looking like right now. Give me some tips on my posing or something like that. While I'm in Mumbai, India, of all places, freaking third world country, getting ready to compete, where my trainer can actually stay home and give me direction online.
Because of the internet now, and back then there was no internet. There were no cell phones. So if you won the Olympia, you'd have to wait for the magazine to come out, or you'd call Venice to find out who won the Olympia. Well, now because of the internet, you see that faster. So I think because of that internet access now, you can train anywhere.
The advancements of technology now, you're going to see the Mr. Olympia that Joe Weider created on the television. You're going to be able to get it on every mobile device that's made now. As a matter of fact, we're already making it possible to see it on your iPhone, Android, BlackBerry, things like this. But the real connection of what people want to do is watch it on the television. So I think at least in the next 2 years, you're going to see a TV quality production on your television that the internet is going to make possible.
I think we need to do is we need to get the younger demographics involved in bodybuilding. You know, the young kids today are in video games and extreme sports and that kind of thing. You know, we need to get these young kids and these young athletes involved in the sport. We need to get them at a young age. Okay, that's how we're going to really grow the participation component, you know, of the sport. Okay, so I think that is going to be the most deciding factor. I think that's going to be a challenge, but I think that's what we need to do. We need to get these young kids interested in bodybuilding.
I think you're going to see a comeback of younger people getting back into it, saying this is pretty great. Maybe on a healthier way to do it, you're going to see that still that bodybuilding era maybe come back. Everything comes back in cycles. I think you're going to see that come back eventually.
One thing we're not going to see happen is Joe's vision of bodybuilding dying off anytime soon. I think we're headed in the right direction, and you know, with people like Jim Mannion at the helm, Rafael Santoja, we are in very good company and very good shape in terms of where we're going. It'll be interesting to see what happens over the next 10 years. I'm going to just sit back and enjoy the ride.
The big prediction I made in the late 50s and early 60s, how bodybuilding would change the whole world. And it did.